My name is Cecil Kunanadak, and I am an IFSA alumnus. I was IFSA president from 93 to 95. Part of my work is at the University of British Columbia, where I'm teaching people studying urban forestry. And then now I'm actually moving into being the program director for a new master's program, the Master of Urban Forestry Leadership. So that's my university job. And then my consultancy job, I'm working a lot with cities, with governments, trying to advise them on how to best green their cities and how to develop what we call nature-based solution. So I was a forestry student in the Netherlands. And then when I graduated, I was really interested in urban forestry. So I started working and doing research. So I've been mostly doing research and then more and more teaching, and then also more and more consultancy work. So I realized this is really interesting interaction between cities on the one hand and people living in cities, and on the other hand, nature and forest on the, in cities as well. Because of course, most of us live in cities these days. So we need to have these close links also in places where we live, I think, with forest and with nature. So I'm really passionate about this connection. I wanted to study forestry and I was interested in nature, but I'm also liking, I live in cities, I work a lot with people, so I want to see how that combination works out. So for me, urban forestry became a really nice combination, right? On the one hand, to work in cities, to deal with people, on the other hand, also really to deal with nature and forests. So so urban forestry turned out for me to be the perfect combination. So I started studying it. It was not really common when I started in the 90s. And then I started learning more and more and doing research on it and also starting to work in different countries. So I worked in Holland, in Scandinavia, in Hong Kong and in Canada, and now I work in Spain. Yeah, so I think actually for me, maybe the first big milestone, apart from understanding what urban forestry was really getting involved with IFSA. So I started meeting people from all over the world, and I realized that I wanted to work internationally. Right? I wanted to work globally. I wanted to make a difference. I didn't want to get stuck in the Netherlands. So that was an important one for me. And then I think the second one was when I did my PhD in Finland. And then I started understanding what it means to be a researcher, right? To dive into a topic for a few years and to really focus on it. So those two are really important. And I think the third main milestone for me was starting to work on international projects. So I did a lot of work on European projects. I worked a lot with colleagues in Asia. And I started really understanding how important it is that we have international collaboration and we share knowledge and experience. And I think that came really from my IFSA connection. The other thing I really found very important is that when I started getting to work in urban forestry, I realized you need to collaborate, right? You need to work with other disciplines. So as a forester, I had to work with landscape architects, with planners, with psychologists, with medical professions. So that means also you have to communicate, right? You have to start speaking the same language. And that is a challenge. I'm sure you also experienced it, right? When you meet people from other disciplines. So that was a major milestone for me to understand that, okay, I'm only doing one part of this as a forester and I have something to contribute, but I have to work with these other professions. So I think, I'm in a lucky position, right? I'm a white guy who was brought up in a very rich country, the Netherlands. So I realized I was in a position where many things were pretty easy for me. I know many of my students, many of my colleagues, they faced many more challenges. For example, for being a woman or for being a person from a different background, different cultural background, or growing up in the global South. So having said that, I think some of the barriers I faced was really, for example, urban forestry. Many foresters didn't like it in the beginning because they thought it was a bit strange to work in cities. So they said, no, you're not a forester. You're more like a landscape architect or so. So I had to fight quite a lot against that, right? So people were always telling me that, oh no, what you do is not real forestry, right? You're not out in the forest with your chainsaw or you're not. So, but that has changed a lot. I think a lot of people now realize that urban forestry is part of forestry. So for me, that was a main barrier. And I think another barrier is exactly the thing I spoke about with the language issue, right? To try to understand other professions and to see that actually forestry, urban forestry, are a very small part in cities because there's so many other interests like education and health and climate adaptation. So we always have to connect to those issues because we are, as such, only a small sector when we don't get so much of the budget. So we have to link up to these other domains. think openness, to be open to other fields. I've always liked, for example, to read a lot about a lot of different fields and disciplines. So I think that openness is pretty important. And I think also language skills. And then I really mean learning different languages so you can speak with people in their own language. And I think in general also communication skills. So when I was a PhD student, I was also working for the TV in the Netherlands, TV station. And I learned a lot about the importance of communication. And foresters, we have not always been very good at that. So I think that's one of the key skills. If you can communicate, and communication means just more listening than talking, obviously, then I think a lot of doors open. For me, it was really this opening my window to the world, right? Understanding there were people all over the world, in the Philippines, in Italy, in North America, that had similar interests than me. I was only 20, I think, when I got involved at IFSA, and we organized the IFSS in the Netherlands in 1991, I think it was. Then I realized that there was this opportunity to work internationally. And for me, that was really a new thing. I hadn't thought about it. So that was really great, right? And then the network, of course, being able as a student to meet some of the leaders in the field during IFSS. And they were always very open to IFSA. A lot of people were very supportive. I think, you know, this is so important, right? And I think IFSA is good also that we are all equal, right? When you're involved in IFSA, it doesn't matter where you're from. It doesn't matter what your background is. We're all equal. Some like sophomore students, PhD students, we're all at the same level. I think that really is a good mentality to bring further into the career. Because in forestry, we need everybody, right? We need people from many different backgrounds. We need men and women. We need people from different cultural backgrounds. So I think we're doing something really good with IFSA as well, right? We're pushing that agenda, a more equal field. So that, of course, when you're IFSA president, it's a nice thing to put on your CV, obviously. I mean, any position you have in IFSA, you show that actually you've been active, right? And so apart from being able to connect, it's always easier when you have a position and you say, hey, I'm working for IFSA, I have this and this position. People are maybe a little bit more willing to talk with you. So if you just reach out as a student, then some professors will say, oh yeah, it's just another student. But if you come with IFSA as an organization, they will say, oh, this is interesting, right? Because we know IFSA, it's part of IUFRO, etc. So I think it has helped me to maybe make those first connections a bit more easily. I would say be open and be ready to make big changes. I think it's really important that you say, well, you don't try to put yourself on a too strict career path, but you try really to think, okay, I'm open to new challenges. And when an opportunity comes, I'm willing to take it, especially early in your career. It may be scary, it may be challenging, but when you get that opportunity, you take it. Then all of a sudden you see new opportunities will start coming. So to be open, to be willing to take a risk or a challenge every now and then, and not to lock yourself too much into a certain career path. I think that would be my piece of advice. It's a great career, especially today, with all the challenges we have. There's so much more awareness about the importance of forests, the importance of nature. I think for many young people coming in, if they see the opportunities, the climate urgency, the public health urgency, I think they will see that this is a really exciting career. You can work in all kinds of organizations. You don't have to work as a forester. You work in international bodies. You can work in politics. You can work in cities. Forestry is a very interesting interdisciplinary field where you bring so many aspects. So for me personally, if I would be young again, I would start again, I would pick forestry again, no doubt.